when you get up from that fire, Harris, ASAP, when you get up, we're grounded. Cruz and Mercy, they breached the scaffold. Like Mackerel now, they have breached the scaffold. They are behind our lines.
Shortly after 2 p.m., the Capitol Police and Metropolitan Police were overwhelmed by President Trump's mob. Perimeters were broken. The Capitol had been breached. Those officers kept fighting back for hours and hours to hold the line. They fought to defend the Capitol building and all of us within it. But they weren't there just to protect us, and they did, and our staff, and the custodial staff, and all the people who worked so hard in this building. They were there to protect the votes of the American people that were being counted that day. I will show you more later about what that day was like for those brave officers. But first, let's go back to what was happening where Manager Plaskett left off in the House chamber. Rioters who had entered the building through the Senate quickly spread out through the Capitol, many headed towards the House and Senate chambers. After Speaker Pelosi was ushered out, Chairman McGovern was presiding in the House, attempting to keep the counting process going. On our phones, members were receiving security updates and watching social media to see the horror that was going on outside. We never thought it would make its way in. By 2:25 p.m., rioters who were already in the building opened the east side doors of the Capitol Rotunda to let more of the mob in. They quickly flooded through the doors, overwhelming the officers. This is new security footage of those doors. And as before, the mob is identified with the red dot on the model of the Capitol. If you look closely, you'll see the first person through the door is holding a Trump flag. At the same time, just one floor below, the mob violently pushed through a line of Capitol Police officers and overtook the area. We all know that area in the Capitol is the crypt. This is directly beneath the rotunda, at the very center of the Capitol. Inside the House chamber, a security officer suspended the floor debate to update members.
We had a disbursement of tear gas in the rotunda. Please be advised there are masks under your seats. Please grab a mask, place it in your lap, and be prepared to don your mask in the event that we get a breach.
We were told there were tear gas masks underneath our seats and be prepared to grab them. Determined to keep the count going, Chairman McGovern called the House back into session. But only 4 minutes later, at 2:30 p.m., the House abruptly recessed. A new security announcement was made.
Get down under your chairs if necessary, so we have folks entering the rotunda and coming down this way. So we'll update you as soon as we can, but just be prepared. Stay calm.
As I heard that announcement on the floor, I saw the new House chaplain, on just her fourth day on the job, walked to the front podium. Unannounced and amidst the chaos, she started to recite a prayer for peace. Uncertain what would happen next, I sent a text message to my wife. I love you and the babies. Please hug them for me. I imagine many of you sent a similar message. What we could not see from inside the chamber was that outside, the mob was growing larger and larger and approaching our doors. But we could hear them. This security footage, which does not have sound, shows a close-up of Trump's mob as they move toward the second floor of the House chamber to stop the counting of votes. In the back of the group, you see one individual carrying a Stop the Steal sign. They get within footsteps of the house door. The next video is the viewpoint of the insurrectionists. It begins with the mob amassing and then cuts ahead to show you their surge to the house door.
We want Trump! We want Trump! We want Trump! We want Trump! We want Trump!
Those doors, to orient you at home, are the doors that the President of the United States walks through when he or she gives a State of the Union address. You may have heard one man yelled, "No violence," and another responded, "It's too late for that. They don't listen without that." They were there to stop the certification of the election. At this point, inside the House chamber, we could now hear the pounding on the doors. At 2:35 p.m., members on the House floor were told an evacuation route was secured and it was time to leave. This video shows members of Congress exiting to the side of the podium where we would go through the House lobby and downstairs. Because of coronavirus restrictions, congressional members had been waiting in the gallery for their time to speak just one level above the House floor. Representatives, staff, journalists all took cover under their chairs, helped each other put on their gas masks, and held hands as rioters gathered outside. Here in this slide, you see Representative Jason Crow comforting our colleague, Representative Susan Wild. The rioters continued to surround the House chamber, flooding the halls and kicking on the doors as they passed them. This security video shows Ashley Babbit, followed by others in the mob, turning the corner toward the House lobby doors where the members were leaving. Chairman McGovern was one of the last members to leave the floor. As he left through the House lobby just after 2:40 p.m., he was spotted by the mob. Minutes later, at 2:44 p.m., Ashley Babbit attempted to climb through a shattered window into the House lobby. To protect the members in the lobby, an officer discharged his weapon, and she was killed. I want to warn everyone that the next video, which shows her death, is graphic. Inside the chamber, representatives, staff, and journalists remain trapped in the gallery, one floor above the House floor, and heard the gunshot. My colleague, Representative Dan Kildee, produced this recording.
Take your pins off!
Yeah. The fuck?
Take your pins off!
Pins off!
Out of fear that they'd be seen, or taken by the mob, my colleagues were telling each other to take off their congressional pins. That buzzing sound that you hear in the background of these videos was the sound of the gas masks. It was not until approximately 2:50 p.m., about 6 minutes after the shooting, downstairs, remaining members, staff, and journalists in the gallery were finally able to flee. In this security footage video, you can see them exiting. Many members are still wearing their gas masks. They walk just feet away from where Capitol Police are holding an insurrectionist at gunpoint. Just minutes earlier, that insurrectionist had tried to open the gallery door and thankfully was stopped by a tactical team. Although members were now being moved to another location, the mob continued to fight, to stop the count, to find the members, to engage with the police. The building was not yet secure. This security video from 2:56 p.m. shows the mob in the House of Representatives wing on the second floor of the Capitol. Insurrectionists who are still inside the building are fighting with the police, who are overwhelmed and trying to get them out. Throughout this presentation, we have been very careful to not share where members of Congress were taken on the paths they followed to get out and off the floors. But that very issue was under discussion by the insurrectionists themselves. One example comes from an FBI affidavit, which stated that a leader of a militia group known as the Oath Keepers received messages while he was at the Capitol. The leader was given directions to where representatives were thought to be sheltering, and instructions to, quote, turn on gas, seal them in. And as you know, the threat to the Senate was no less than that of the members of the House. The mob approached the Senate with the same purpose, fulfilling President Trump's goal of stopping the count, delaying the certification of the Electoral College votes of the American people. As you heard from Manager Plaskett, Vice President Pence was moved away from the area near the Senate chamber around 2:25 p.m. By that time, rioters had breached several areas close to this chamber, and they were flooding the hallways just outside and nearby. The Senate chamber was not evacuated until 2:30 p.m. The mob had been in the building for more than 15 minutes. This new security footage of the senators and staff leaving the chamber will be displayed on the screens. It is silent. You cannot see it in this footage, but quick-thinking Senate floor staff grabbed and protected the electoral ballots that the mob was after. Those of you who were here that day will recall that once you left the Senate floor, you moved through a hallway to get to safety. That hallway was near where Officer Goodman had encountered a mob and led them upstairs and away from the Senate chamber. You know how close you came to the mob. Some of you, I understand, could hear them, but most of the public does not know how close these rioters came to you. As you were moving through that hallway, I paced it off. You were just 58 steps away from where the mob was amassing and where police were rushing to stop them. They were yelling. In this security video, you can see how the Capitol Police created a line and blocked the hallway with their bodies to prevent rioters at the end of the hall from reaching you and your staff. Because this is security footage that you have not seen before, I want to play it again. At the top of the screen is the other end of that hallway where the mob has amassed and the officers are rushing to protect you. Additional security footage shows how Leader Schumer and the members of his protective detail had a near miss with the mob. They came within just yards of rioters and had to turn around. Here in this new video, you see Leader Schumer walking up a ramp, going up the ramp with his detail. He'll soon go out of view. Seconds later, they return and run back down the hallway, and officers immediately shut the door and use their bodies to keep them safe. At 2:45 p.m., shortly after senators were ushered to safety from the Senate floor, insurrectionists reached this Senate gallery. The following video was filmed by a New Yorker reporter.
Where the fuck are they?
Minutes later, the insurrectionists invaded and desecrated the Senate floor. These vandals shouted and rifled through the desks in this room. They took pictures of documents and of themselves, celebrating that they had taken over the floor and stopped the counting of Electoral College votes.
I want to just get a snap of that.
Yeah, I took a picture.
Hey, how did y'all get down there?
We're down the stairs.
Look.
Ted Cruz's objection to the Arizona.
Cruz's objection. He was going to sell us out all along.
Really?
Look, objection to counting electoral votes of the state of Arizona.
Wait, no, that's
not. Oh, no, that's actually okay. All right.
He's with us.
There's got to be something here. You're fucking using this, scumbags.
We're not going to fall, man!
America's Republic. Oh, no, this is good stuff.
Hey! We're not going to fall!
Larry Brock, who was arrested for his role in the insurrection, was photographed on the Senate floor wearing a helmet, tactical gear, and carrying flex cuffs. This man, also in the Senate gallery, is Eric Munchell. Like Brock, he was dressed in what appears to be tactical gear, also holding up flex cuffs. If the doors to this chamber had been breached just minutes earlier, imagine what they could have done with those cuffs. After insurrectionists occupied the Capitol and stopped the joint session from counting the votes, the Capitol was in lockdown for 5 hours. As long as it took to get back to the Capitol, to get back to the certification of the election, it could have been so much longer. Or we might not have been able to have resumed at all. As horrific as it was, 140 officers injured, three officers who ultimately lost their lives, we all know that awful day could have been so much worse. The only reason it was not was because of the extraordinary bravery of the men and women of the Capitol Police and the Metropolitan Police Departments. For hours and hours, these insurrectionists were in hand-to-hand combat with these brave men and women. Like some of you, I come from a law enforcement family. My dad was a cop. My two brothers, my little brothers, are cops who walk the beat today. I'm proud of them. And like in every law enforcement family, when we hang up the phone, we don't only say, "I love you," we say, "Be safe." So let's focus now on the attack and what it was like for the officers defending the Capitol that day. And again, I want to warn you that the following audio and videos are graphic and are unsettling. But it's important that we understand the extent of what occurred. Here's an audio recording from the radio traffic of the DC Metropolitan Police Department describing the violence.
We're still taking rock, bottle, and piece of the flag, and metal pole. Cruiser 50, the crowd is using munitions against us. They have bear spray in the crowd. Bear spray in the crowd.
Okay.
DSO, I need a re-up up here.
You hear the officer describe they're using munitions. The rioters are using munitions against us. This video shows how the sprays that were described were used against the officers. In a separate Metropolitan Police Department radio traffic recording, you can hear an officer when he realizes that the insurrectionists had overtaken the police line.
We lost the line. OMPD, pull back. OMPD, pull back up to the upper deck. OMPD, pull back to the upper deck. ASAP. OMPD, come back to the upper deck. Upper deck. Cruz 50 has blanked. 1033. I repeat, 1033 has burned the capital. We've been blanked and we've lost the line.
The MPD officer calls out 1033. That's the code for emergency. Officer in need of assistance. His words, we've lost the line. Hours after members of the House and Senate had left this area, on the west front of the building, the mob continued to grow, continued to beat the officers as they tried to get in. In this new security video, you can see the mob attacking officers with a crutch, a hockey stick, a bullhorn, and a Trump flag. I want to show you that same attack from the officer's perspective from his body camera footage. This body camera footage is from 4:27 p.m., over 2 hours from when the Capitol was first breached. The attack on police that afternoon was constant. Metropolitan Police Officer Michael Fanone, a 20-year police veteran with four daughters, was part of a line of officers protecting the Capitol. He was one of three officers that the mob dragged down the stairs. When they dragged him, they stole his badge, his radio, his ammunition magazine, and they tased him, triggering a heart attack. Here he describes his experience.
It looked like a medieval battle scene. You know, it was some of the most brutal combat, you know, I've ever encountered. At one point I got tased. People were yelling out, you know, we got one.
Officer Christina Lowry, who regularly serves in MPD's Narcotics and Specialized Investigation Division, also protected the front Capitol entrance. Here's her experience.
I mean, I can't say enough about the officers that were there, the officers that were on the front line. And when I say the front line, I mean literally officers that were in a line, stopping these people that were beating them with metal poles. They were spraying them with bear mace. I mean, they did everything in their power to not let those people in. And this was going on for hours.
Around 4:30 p.m., hours into the Capitol riots, Officer Daniel Hodges was protecting a West Side Capitol entrance when rioters who were trying to stop the certification trapped him between two doors. When Officer Hodges was interviewed later, this is how he described what was happening.
They threw down a huge metal object that hit me in the head. I was also knocked down. The medical mask I was wearing at the time got pulled up over my eyes, so I was on the ground and blinded, and they started just attacking me from all sides.
Rioters crushed Officer Hodges. He was wedged in the doorway, blood dripping from his mouth. He was struggling to breathe, all while the insurrectionists hit him. Officer Hodges' experience reminds you of what he and many other officers experienced that day, what they went through. We're also reminded of the three officers who lost their lives, Capitol Hill police officers Sicknick, Liebengood, and Metropolitan Police Officer Smith. In many law enforcement families, we pray for our loved ones, and we know the scripture of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. I'm sorry I have to show you the next video, but in it you will see how blessed we were that on that hellish day, we had a peacemaker like Officer Hodges, protecting our lives, our staff's lives. This Capitol and the certification process. May we do all we can in this chamber to make sure that never happens again.
Mr. President, we'll now have a recess for dinner and we'll resume at 6:15.
The Senate will stand in recess.